Thanks very much. I'm very conscious I'm the only thing between you and a free drink, so I'm going to take my responsibility to keep the time even more seriously than I might do otherwise. So I'm going to be talking about data as well, and data of perhaps of a slightly different sort than Ben has been talking about research data and what the role, I think primarily of librarians. Much of my talk is going to be aimed at librarians, but I'm going to touch on roles around publishers as well. But actually, I hope you'll see that there are actually many connections between some of the things we're going to be talking about, research data, and some of the issues that have been brought up by previous speakers. And in particular, that issue of reuse and exploitation and sharing applies to all of these types of data, no matter where it comes from. So I think it's always worthwhile beginning a talk like this with hyperbole. Data is the new oil. There's one example of that. You know, we're all going to become the J.R. Ewings, perhaps, of data if we get this job right. And another statement there from somebody from O'Reilly Media, the future belongs to companies and people that turn data into products. Now, that second statement perhaps doesn't seem to speak to us very much. This is about, you know, what the Amazons and the Tescos and the Facebooks and the Twitters of this world perhaps are doing with data that they get from us for free and turn it back into products for others. But actually, if you substitute some of those words and rethink them a bit, I think the future certainly belongs to researchers and institutions that turn their data into something that gets used more than once. That's not, in a sense, simply a disposable product, but something that has a life longer than an individual project, longer than an individual publication. And I hope to persuade you of that a bit in the next few minutes. So I'll spend a bit of time trying to convince you, you know, perhaps not all of you really care about this issue of research data. Perhaps you don't see it apply to you. And I hope to persuade you why you ought to care. And then, hoping that I've got your attention there, say a little about what you might want to do to take a role in the management of research data institution and how you might get there, and one or two things that perhaps you should avoid doing if you want to get the job right. I'm struck again by it just so happened this weekend, I was reading a book by one of Britain's greatest science fiction authors, Brian Aldiss, written nearly 20 years ago. And in one of the commentaries on one of the stories there, he was saying, even then, information has become a saleable commodity like never before. And yet, at the same time, many of us are not valuing information. 33% of the people, this was a survey done in Great Britain in 1999, the very similar figures from other countries and other times, 33% of people still didn't know that the Earth orbits the sun. That implies that they're placing a fairly low value on some bits of knowledge, but it also implies, coming back to that statement of data is the new oil, that those who do place a high value on a data have a, you know, are in a position to get the upper hand on the rest. And I think the same, again, is true of researchers and universities that get to grips with the information and the data in their possession, they can gain a leap over the others who perhaps are slower to do the right things there. So I come from this organization called the Digital Curation Center, and it's worth perhaps just touching a little bit on what curation means in this context when we're dealing with data. So one of the definitions, ones that we encourage, is this idea of maintaining, preserving, and adding value to research data throughout its life cycle. So this is more than simply preserving stuff. People often think of this as in some way just simply equating to digital preservation. It implies some sort of active management, and it implies dealing with change in the context of usage of the information, dealing with change in the knowledge base of those who might be using the data over time. But it's also somewhat less than preservation, because curation done properly means throwing stuff away as well as keeping it. It means recognizing that not everything is worth keeping forever, that some of this data really needs to have a limited lifetime. And we may not know exactly what that lifetime is at the point it's created, but we should be actively managing it and recognizing when we need to retire certain things and what things really do deserve some added effort going into to maintaining them in the longer term. And it's sometimes related to publication, and it's sometimes related to sharing, and it's sometimes related to citation, but not always. Those things are important, but they're not the be-all and the end-all of what it's about. So some of the issues, why should you, or why should your institution, why should your, as a publisher, as a university, why should you care about the issues of long-term data management? Well, you know, one simple reason is that most of this stuff has come from research, and research is expensive. And that means that we can see the data in some way as, you know, it's representative of an investment that somebody has made. And we want to get the best value out of that investment. And there are lots and lots of cases that show us that we can exploit data again and again, and that means that we are getting the great value for our investment. So the idea that we can reuse data in the context of research, we can also reuse it in the context of teaching and learning, teaching the next generation of students how to generate data effectively, how to do research. And it can also help with planning, and particularly when we look at data moving back and forth between the worlds of academia and industry and government, this is increasingly important. Not all the data that researchers are interested in has come from academic research, and similarly, some of the data that's generated by academic research is of interest outside those contexts as well. Good management of data also can help us generate impact for what we're doing, whether or not it's tied to a publication. It's important in terms of accountability, and it's also important in legal and regulatory requirements, whether it be things like freedom of information, whether it be about data protection, which tells us what we can't share as well as what we can share, whether it be the sort of regulatory requirements that come from funders, or intriguingly, or seeing in comments from a conference going on in New Zealand at the moment about digital preservation, Future Perfect. And a speaker there from the Church of the Latter-day Saints, talking about the petabytes of data that they manage, talked about the spiritual imperative that they have to manage their data. They're not doing it because the law says so, they're doing it because the Book of Mormon tells them they need to do it. And if that works for you, then that's fine, you know, whatever it is that we need to get attention from those above us. And I could summarize all that by saying, you know, there are positive and negative reasons for doing this. But in general, if you don't do research data management well, then negative things will cause bad things to happen. You know, you won't meet legal and regulatory requirements. And if you do it right, good stuff will happen. You'll get more value out of the research that you get. You'll get more impact out of the research that you're doing. So let's talk a little bit about some of the regulatory requirements that are getting the attention of a lot of people at, you know, PVC research level in the UK at the moment. EPSRC, the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, one of our largest research funders, has generated a set of requirements for institutions with some deadlines attached, some of which are relatively close. It expects every institution it funds to develop a roadmap for effective research data management that align with its expectations by the 1st of May this year. And 3 years after that, it expects to see compliance with that roadmap. That's worrying a lot of people at high level and a lot of institutions at the moment. And it's interesting that that funder has taken a slightly different route from any other funders like the NSF in the States or the NARC in the UK, who tend to place requirements on the principal investigators and the people who are being funded rather than the institutions that they're part of. And those expectations, as it puts it, that it wants us to align with include things like the awareness of the regulatory environment that I mentioned, some data access statements, formal policies and processes about how the institution goes about managing this. If somewhere to keep the data, you know, a pretty basic requirement, you need some storage for it, structured metadata descriptions, digital object identifiers, and that last one, which really is worrying many people, that all the data that comes from a research project is securely preserved for a minimum of 10 years from the last time it's been used, not simply 10 years from the time that a research project happened. So that potentially is generating a very long-term requirement. Although, you know, if you have to keep data for 100 years because it keeps getting reused, you know, that's a good thing, not a bad thing. That means that, you know, your research has been so valuable that people again and again and again want to return to what you found out. So I'm going to talk a little about what you can do and whatever in terms of this life cycle model, something the Digital Curation Center developed, to try and understand all the different actions that can take place from somebody having an idea, conceptualizing some research, through data being created, reused, managed in lots of different ways. Now, some people feel this is a little too complicated. I can assure you, we looked at lots of other life cycle models along the way. We built on the best of them. And I hope what we have is the essence. We did think, that one, incidentally, that's not a whole model, that's just part of something that came out of a project called Inter Pares. And I really do struggle to understand how something like that can help any of us do a reasonable job of managing something. But clearly there are people who believe that things like that are helpful. I'm glad I don't work with them. So, to return to this model, I think there are two areas there where libraries have a particular role to play, and that's around two sides of this: appraising and selecting things. In other words, choosing what it's worth keeping and choosing how we're going to manage stuff, and managing those issues around access and use and reuse. Being the people who ensure that stuff can be found, that it can be reused, and detaching that from having to go back to the people who did the research in the first place. The really effective way to scale data reuse is to decouple it from its original creators, and indeed to allow that data to be reused after they've left the institution, after they've retired, after they've died, even. And there are two different publications here that can help us understand a bit more about some of these roles. And I apologize here that the one on the left appears to be one from one of the few publishers who isn't a sponsor of this event, from Facet. A book called Managing Research Data, edited by one of my colleagues at the DCC, Graham Pyre. And in particular, an article in there from Sheila Correll, who I'm sure will be familiar to many of you from the University of Sheffield, about libraries, librarians, and data, and many, many ideas for action in that. And also a report there from RLUK about reskilling for research, skills gaps for subject librarians. And I'd encourage any of you who want to know a little more about how you can rethink some libraries to look at those. But I'll summarize some of the key points of what roles libraries can play in individual librarians. Well, in many cases, you can play a leadership role in your institution, coordinating action, which doesn't mean doing everything, but it means making sure that you get together all of the people who together can do something. And that's going to include people from research administration, it's going to include people from IT, from grants management, and from the researchers themselves. Audit roles as well, getting a simple idea at the moment of what have we got at the moment and who thinks they're responsible for it. Everything from the USB keys that are sitting in somebody's drawer to the stuff that's being managed on big high-performance computing infrastructures. Most universities haven't got a clue what's there, and we've seen many embarrassing stories around freedom of information access requests to university research data that basically come down to that problem of people not knowing what's there. Giving people advice on access, not just to the data that you've got in your own institution, but the data that's elsewhere, is another, again, role that libraries can play. Preservation, ensuring citability, and that linking together of data and publication. I'll say a little more about why that's really important to do. And also helping to promote data in teaching. And I can mention a bunch of other roles as well, including perhaps the training of future generations of researchers, postgraduates in particular, to have better data management practices than their predecessors did. I mean, that's playing a fairly long game. That's trying to ensure that a generation that comes afterwards will have different expectations. So I'll touch on one or two tools and ways in which, in some cases, the DCC can help you and others can help you meet some of those requirements. One, in that understanding requirements, we've developed a tool called CARDIO, the Collaborative Assessment of Research Data Infrastructures and Objectives. We do like these artificially constructed acronyms. So this is a simple tool that helps you begin to understand the data management requirements and the capacity to meet them in your own institution. So it's a way of rating yourself and saying, okay, you know, here are the things that need to be done. Here are the things that actually, you know, we probably can already do fairly well. And here are the gaps. and begin to assess how you might meet those gaps and how long it might take you to deal with it. Some practical goals for small steps to improvement. Otherwise, it's too easy to become paralyzed by what appears to be a big and challenging problem. Another more specific tool that we know is getting large uptake. I mean, these are actually two examples of tools from the US and the UK to do similar things, are meeting the increasing requirements of funders to produce things called data management plans. These are things that funders want a statement up front before your research gets funded about what type of data do you expect to generate and how are you going to manage it over its lifetime? Who do you think is going to need access to it? How are you going to provide that access and who is going to be responsible for it? So tools that make that job easier are you know, simplifying one part of the getting the grants for researchers, so that's good for the institutions as well. And libraries in the US, the UK and Europe are all seeing it as their role to support people doing that. We've also produced a series of simple how-to guides, and some of them in collaboration with partners overseas, the one on the right there with our colleagues in Australia from the Australian National Data Service, to solve some particular problems. How giving guidance on how to cite data sets, for instance, and link them to publications, and how to deal with that other job of appraisal and selection, where I also said libraries and indeed archives, I think, can play a significant role. And we've also produced advice on how to license data, both to open it up as much as possible or to protect it when that's the appropriate thing to do, and guidance on some of the license mechanisms. And there's also tools to track impact in the wider sense than simply citations of publications. This is one example of them, total impact. Now, I think for libraries to provide advice to researchers in their institutions on how to make use of things is a role that you could aspire to. Now, this issue about citability, you know, I mean, it sounds like, you know, it's an end in itself, but actually there's good reasons for wanting to make data citable in itself, not simply as something that's part of a publication, although where publications are involved, you do want to tie the two things together. There's lots of evidence for a number of fields that making data findable and citable increases the citations both to the data and to the publications that it's attached to, and it increases the reuse and therefore the value of the data. And those effects exist, although somewhat more weakly, even when there isn't a scientific paper associated with the data. Now, this is something where everybody wins. Unlike lots of the other things in data management, where there are costs for some of the actors and benefits for others, if you increase the citation of the stuff, the researchers like it, the institution likes it, and the publisher likes it. You know, what's not to like about doing that, and why aren't we doing that job better? So, a little more about how we can achieve some of those ends. Well, doing things like meeting those EPSIC roadmaps involves usually creating policy in your institutions, and that's something where you will want to collaborate with others. The library on its own cannot do that, but we've seen many examples where the libraries can be leading those activities, and we're working with a number of institutions to help that happen. Developing the existing services you've got, reskilling, learning about data. I'm going to pick out just one or two of these things. So I don't think we've got time to go through them all and say a little bit more about how you can do it. Well, I've already mentioned Cardio, one of the tools we've got to try and get a picture of data management in your institution. We've also got a more specific tool called the Data Audit Framework that helps you deal with things like capacity development, will help your colleagues in IT services understand what sort of capacity you need to build to manage data and what sort of risks you've already got where data might already be lost, perhaps when you've already made a commitment to hang on to it. And those tools are designed to work either at the level of entire institutions or at the level of individual departments. Reskilling librarians, which is something I think would be important to all of us. Here is a report from about 4 years ago done by Alma Swan looking at skills issue and skills gaps and how to reskill existing folks to deal with the increasing requirements for data management. And some of the quotes in this, I think, are rather telling now, 4 years on. I think we've perhaps not made as much progress as we ought to do in meeting the challenges that were set here. There are not enough specialized data librarians yet, and the recommendation to us, the research library community should work with universities and research institutions to formalize the role of data librarians, to develop a curriculum that ensures a suitable supply of librarians skilled in data handling. Now, I know, for instance, our colleagues in the Netherlands at TU Delft in particular have done a great deal of work here. They've produced a course specifically designed to do this, and we're looking at reusing that in the UK. But here's, again, a statistics from 4 years ago, nearly, that there were only five people described as data librarians in the UK then. And one of the reasons I haven't updated this slide is that the number hasn't really changed very much in the 5 years. I think it might have crept up to 10, but that's still far short, I think, of what we actually need. And helping to promote data literacy in our own institution, again, is another role that I think libraries are well suited to dealing with. And this project, which involved some of my colleagues in the DCC and folks in the University of Cambridge, Incremental, is one example of how to do that. But there are many, many others, and I encourage you to look at the DCC website to find out examples of more on those. One thing that it's important to remember in all of this is that libraries and universities are not going to solve all of this problem. There are people in data centers who are already dealing with this very, very well for certain subject domains, but by no means all. And that's where it's important, I think, for universities to step in and fill the gap. Well, what you don't want to do is to try and get in the way of what are already successful workflows for some research groups with some data centers. Exploit and perhaps ease those paths if possible. And be aware also that trying to treat data exactly like a publication is not the right way to go. The boundaries of data sets are somewhat fuzzier than those of publications. They tend to be subject to more continual change. They're multidimensional and often highly non-linear, although they do share some characteristics. Beware also, I said I'll tell you some things not to do. This is certainly one of the things not to do, and this is a message to the publishers as well as to the libraries. There is this problem, a quote from Clay Shirky, institutions will try to preserve the problem to which they're the solution. And that idea, perhaps, of thinking too much around the types of material that we're already used to managing, the types of publications that we're already used to managing, and trying to make data fit into that model is not going to help anyone, and I think we'll just end up costing you time and effort and eventually being left to one side. So this is partly a summary. It's partly also an opportunity for me to introduce one or two new points that I didn't get the chance to put in earlier. Think of data as being more than just an adduct to publication. Remember that in managing data, and particularly helping scholars to find and reuse data, that the data that's interesting in research is more than just the data that's the product of scholarly research. Many of you are already accustomed to being able to provide access, and those who've been working as data librarians for many years are also familiar, for instance, with the large collections of government data that are important in so many areas of social science and economics, but in other disciplines as well. Hidden data is wasted data. If you can't find data, then you can't reuse it and you can't cite it, and it's not going to get impact, even if you can't provide open access to the data. Simply providing access to metadata about it will help increase the impact of the research that's there. And repeat that message again that, you know, if you don't get this job right, bad things will happen. If you get it right, good things will happen. I'll end, just in case you haven't got any questions for me, I thought I'd end with some questions for you. You might want to consider some of these things, particularly that idea of, you know, what can you do for yourselves? What can you do? What will you need to do with others in your institutions, and what skills you'll need to acquire? I'll end that last point about what you want from us. For those of you who aren't aware, we're funded at the moment specifically to help individual institutions try and make some incremental steps and build capacity in this area. So we're working, for instance, at the University of Surrey with Kate and colleagues. We're also running roadshows around the country to try and help you and your colleagues understand more about what we can do. We were in Salford last week. We're going to be in Newcastle next week. We're going to be in London shortly after that. And I think Dundee and then Belfast. Check the website to find out where we're going to be. Go to the one that's nearest to you if you haven't been already, and find out about how we can help your institution deal properly with this issue of research data and gain the great benefits that can accrue if you do. I'll stop at that point. Thanks very much.